fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead. Can be seated.
We'll be going back to some more music very soon, but I'm going to start us off a little bit about our meditation for the afternoon. You know, one of my family's favorite board games is the game Clue. I don't know if we have any Clue fans here. Many of you have played the game. You got your board, which really the board is kind of set up as a house, different rooms, and you have a number of different characters. You have Mr. Green, Professor Plum, my personal favorite. You have Miss Scarlet, Mrs. Peacock, and there's two more buried here somewhere, Colonel Mustard and Mrs. White. And the aim of the game is a murder has taken place. You're trying to figure out who committed the murder, what weapon was used, and what room the murder took place in. You know, for some reason, even as Americans, we tend to have a fascination with murder mysteries. You see the theme often in movies and on TV shows. And when you think about the story of Good Friday, there's a little bit of a murder mystery you can look at there. I mean, 2,000 years ago, you had this man named Jesus, a man like anyone else. He, He claimed to be God in the flesh, and he backed it up with miracles. I mean, the weather obeyed him. He gave sight to the blind. He even rose people from the dead. And then 2,000 years ago, Jesus was nailed to a cross. We know what instrument of death it was. It was crucifixion, being nailed to the cross. We know where it happened, at Golgotha. And ask the question, who killed Jesus? Who put him on that cross? And there are a number of different candidates that we could point to. I mean, probably some of the first suspects would be the soldiers, the Roman soldiers. I mean, they were there. They were the ones that tortured Jesus. They whipped him. They nailed him to the cross. They bartered to see who would get his clothes. Clearly, we can look at the soldiers and say they were the ones that killed Jesus. And while definitely they were a part of it, we know from looking at the gospel stories that they didn't do it on their own. They were ordered to do that. They were the tools that were used to commit the murder. But there was someone else who gave them those orders. Someone else who probably need to look to for the ultimate blame. Next person on our list is the Roman governor Pontius Pilate. You know, he's the one that gave the order, Jesus, be crucified. He's the one that told the soldiers to do that. The Apostles' Creed, which contains really the one of the earliest list of Christian beliefs that we have. This is only probably about 100 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus. It has this line, Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, who suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. And that line seems to implicate Pilate as being the murderer. No, every gospel account reveals Pilate being involved. But the gospel accounts also show the lengths that he went to not have to crucify Jesus. In John 19:6, Pilate announces that, as for me, I find no basis of charge against this man. Later in verse 12, it literally says he kept trying to find ways to set Jesus free. One of the most famous scenes about Pilate we find in the book of Matthew. And many of you know this story. As the crowd is demanding the death of Jesus, he gets a bowl of water, washes his hands, and says, all right, my hands are free of this. The responsibility goes to the Jews. It is your responsibility. He allows the crucifixion then to happen, and it passes the buck on to someone else. When you look at Pilate, clearly he deserves some credit for his cowardice. I mean, he represents the Roman Empire. He has a massive army at his disposal, and he allows this mob to essentially force him to do something. He could have called down the power of Rome. His own wife pleads with him to let Jesus go, but yet he gives in out of fear of the crowd. But as you continue to look at the Gospels, I mean, yes, Pilate was involved. His cowardice led to that. So we'll find there are some other people who are pulling the strings. Other people that we can point the finger at. And we'll be getting to that in a few moments. I want to invite Amy to come back up. We're going to do a few more songs together.
Would you stand? Mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend. The agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect Holy One, crushed your Son, who drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. By your perfect sacrifice, I've been brought near. Your enemy, you've made your friend. Pouring out the riches of your glorious grace, your mercy and your kindness know no end. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Lover of my soul, I want to live for my soul, I want to live for you.
Sing that again.
Lover of my soul, I want to live for you. Lover of my soul, washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you. Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain. I wouldn't trade it for anything. 'Cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart, and I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. Now I'm standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness. And I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. 'Cause I'm thankful for the scars. 'Cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. And I'm thankful for your scars. 'Cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And with my life I'll tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful. I'm thankful for the scars. 'Cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know forever I am thankful for the scars. So forever I am thankful for the scars.
Amen. You can take a seat.
So far we've looked at the soldiers. We've looked at Pilate. There's another group of people that should definitely be looked at as suspects. That's those of the high priests, the religious leaders. You know, we see in the Gospels, they were very threatened by Jesus, and threatened for a number of reasons. First of all, there have already been a number of revolutions against the Roman Empire that have ended in the Roman just crushing opposition. There have been death left and right, and many religious leaders looked at Jesus and they saw another revolution in the making, could imagine all the death that would occur. As the high priest once said, better for one man to die than for many. You get Jesus out of the way, you save Jewish lives. Also, the religious leaders, there's a lot of power in being the religious authorities of that time. And Jesus challenged their authority. If the people started following Jesus, they would stop following them and their power would be in jeopardy. We're told it's the religious leaders who pay Judas to betray Jesus. In Mark 15:10, Pilate recognizes that it's out of self-interest that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to them. You have multiple verses talking about how the religious leaders are out there getting the crowd into an uproar. Clearly, they're inspiring much of the violence aimed at Jesus. From their mindset, Jesus had to go. Their power and life was at stake. And clearly, they should be at the top of the list of those that we could cast blame. But not just them. Because while they clearly had a leading role in the crucifixion, there's a crowd that we find showing up in the story. Yes, the leaders were stoking the crowd, but the crowd is not innocent. They're very complicit in the moment. And actually, if you look in the book of Luke, that's emphasized. As Pilate is trying to find a way to release Jesus, it's the crowd demanding, crucify him, crucify him. One passage in Luke says, but with loud shouts, they instantly demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. Later in Acts chapter 2, Peter, this is following the death and resurrection of Jesus. Peter is looking at this crowd of Jews and he's telling them about Jesus. And he accuses them of being the ones who had crucified Jesus. One early Christian leader during the third century talked about the Jewish crowd being guilty. And you look at the crowd and you ask again, why? Why would this crowd turn on Jesus like that? I mean, the same crowd that a week before was yelling, Hosanna, was claiming him as king. Well, one of the primary reasons is their belief that Jesus was going to assert their greatness, make them feel good about how the Jews are better than everyone else. They assumed that Jesus would set up this great earthly kingdom and get rid of the Romans. But Jesus hadn't done that. Instead, Jesus had challenged them. He had condemned Jerusalem as a city that had failed to bear fruit and talked about coming judgment. As far as they were concerned, Jesus was being a traitor to their cause. When you look back on the guilty candidates, whether it's the soldiers or Pilate or religious leaders or the Jewish crowd, really, it's not as cut and dry as we would like. You can see that they all had a role in what occurred that day. Over the past 2,000 years, many have pointed fingers in that direction. But when you look at the bigger picture of the Bible, it points the finger beyond just those groups. See, the prophet Isaiah, who lived 700 years before the time of Jesus, received a vision from God about the coming Messiah, about what Jesus would do. I want you to see what he writes in Isaiah chapter 53. This is talking about Jesus. He grew up before them like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we would desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that had brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of all. Do you notice who Isaiah points the finger at in those verses? All of us. There's that line, he was pierced for our transgressions. Most of you know the story that from the very beginning of time, human beings who were made to walk with God have been in rebellion against God. We decided we know better. We want to do it our way. We decided to reject him as our Lord. And because of that, we've earned the punishment of death, separation from God forever. But the beauty of God's love for us is that he didn't leave us in that place of condemnation. He sent his only son. God in the flesh came to earth to become one of us. And then on the cross, what he did is he took the punishment that we deserve. What put him on that cross? It's our sin. It's all the things that, all the times that we've said, God, that we know better. Every time we've gone outside of his plan. You know, I think back to the whole story of different suspects. I mean, you have the soldiers. Here they are, they're nailing Jesus to the cross. Little did they know that the execution they are carrying out, that Jesus is doing that for them. That their very sin was nailing him to that cross. You know, Pilate, you know, he's there washing his hands saying, I'm innocent, it's not me. But yet Pilate, his sin, put Jesus on that cross just as much as anyone. He wasn't innocent. You know, the Jewish leaders thought they were preserving the Jewish order. They were eliminating a troublemaker, a possibility of revolt. However, it was their troublemaking, their sin, that made Jesus' death necessary. You know, the crowd saw Jesus. He's a barrier to their national dreams. Yet Jesus is dying for them so that they might be restored to God, that they might become citizens of heaven. Looking around this room, he died for our sin. It's the wrong choices we've made that have put him there. Every time we've told a lie, every time we've had an outburst of anger that's hurt others, any time that we've gossiped, when we've held on to a lustful thought, it's those things that put Jesus on the cross. And the finger is pointed at us with the declaration of guilty. Who killed the Son of God? We did, by our rebellion against him. Now, when we think about even the word sin, that's a word that we don't really like to talk about much. We have a culture that tends to take sin very lightly. You know, when it comes to just a small little lie, just to think, oh, God's really not that serious about it. We're forgiven. It doesn't really matter. And yet to think that every time that we sin, regardless of how little we think of it, every time that we do that, we're doing an act that nailed Jesus to the cross. One thing we need to recognize is that sin is a very serious thing. Sin is what put Jesus here. And one thing I want to challenge you right now is maybe God's speaking to you in this stillness of this dark room as we reflect on Good Friday, maybe to ask the question, God, is there an area in my life that I'm sinning, that I'm taking far too lightly? Maybe God's saying right now, it's time to make that right. It's time to repent. Time to embrace God's forgiveness and go in the other direction. Time to realize that it's no small thing, but it truly is a horrible thing. It's something that led to the death of our Lord. But maybe there's still more to the story. And we're going to wrap it up with this here. In the book of John, Jesus says this about himself. He said, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for my sheep. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. Our sin put Jesus on the cross, but Jesus was no powerless victim. Ultimately, he made the choice to give up his life. And why? Because even though our sin put him there, he loved us so much that he would do whatever it took for us to be restored to God. He loved us so much that he would say, that punishment you deserve, I'm going to take it on myself. See, Jesus chose to die on the cross to show us the extent of his love. We're going to do one final song, and during that song, I'm going to invite you to do something. Up here, we have a communion element. And before Jesus' death, he took a piece of bread and broke it, and he said, this is my body that's broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. He took some wine. We like to call it grape juice. And he said, this is my blood that was shed for you. Drink this in remembrance of me. And we do that regularly to remember his sacrifice. Remember the love that he poured out on us. I'm going to invite you as we do this next song, sing along, but also God, ask God to search your heart. Maybe there is a sin area in your life that you need to repent of. Take the time to do that. And then I invite you, when you're ready, come up here, take a piece of bread, take some juice, take it back to your seat, and when you're comfortable, take communion as a way of saying, Jesus, thank you for your gift. Again and again, I embrace that. I worship you. I invite you, you can even do it as a family. If you have kids, it's an opportunity to teach your kids what communion is. Also, we do have a few of these on the side that do have some gluten-free crackers. So if you are not gluten-free, don't grab those. If you are, feel free to receive one of those. But anytime during a song, come up, take communion, bring it back to your seat, and take communion either by yourself or with your family. I'm going to pray for us, and then Amy will lead us in some more music. Father, I want to thank you for this time. Oh, Father, may it sink in what you did for us. May we recognize our choices that have led to this, recognize that we're people that we don't deserve anything good. We deserve judgment.
But yet, God, you have acted on our behalf. Father, your blood, body was broken, your blood was shed so that we could be forgiven, so that we could be restored to you, so we could experience the fullness of your blessing. Oh, Father, that blows my mind. Lead us into a time of worship. And Lord, as we search our hearts, may your spirit be at work. If there's something we need to confess, may you bring that to mind. And Lord, may we lay that before the cross and leave here free. We ask that in the name of Jesus. Amen. So it's available on both sides.
Strong and bless your name.
So on that Friday, Jesus was nailed to the cross and he died there. And our sin was nailed there with him. Our sin died there with him. His followers went home thinking that was the end. The Messiah was dead. He was gone. Game over. They went home with the mindset that there was no hope. Little did they know that 2 days later, Easter morning was coming. That this cross was not the end of the story. I invite you back on Sunday. On Sunday, we'll be celebrating the resurrection. Celebrating that Jesus walked out of that grave more alive than ever. Inviting us into new life in him. If you join me in prayer. Father, I do want to thank you for this time. And Lord, as we go home from here, may the image of the cross be in our minds. May it be in our hearts. Tomorrow, Lord, may we also remember as we wait to celebrate your resurrection. To celebrate Sunday, the day when all was made new. Prepare us for that. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. May God bless you this weekend.